At a nuclear power plant, unstable uranium nuclei are undergoing radioactive decay. All the actions take place inside this reactor, where nuclear fission occurs. It's where the nuclei of uranium isotopes break apart, creating energy that heats up water, turning it into the steam that powers the turbines and converts that energy into useful electricity. One of the biggest challenges is storing the used fuel left over from these fission reactions. These byproducts are radioactive. In this segment, we're going to talk about half-life and why some radioactive materials can last a long time. Joining me is Michael McCracken at Plant Vogel. Michael, explain what happens to the spent fuel and why you take so much care to store and contain it.
The used fuel that we placed into the spent fuel pool can stay in there for decades. We've had fuel in there since the 1987, 1988 time period. After a number of years, after at least 5 years, you can take out that used fuel from the wet storage or the pool storage and place it into canisters. And that's what we have behind us, or spent fuel. It's called dry cask canisters. And it's basically the fuel is inside a stainless steel canister that's welded shut. And then that stainless steel canister is placed inside a double wall metal canister that's then filled with concrete. So there's multiple layers of metal and concrete, and that keeps the used fuel safe inside. So people can walk right by it and not receive, absorb much radiation at all.
Thanks, Michael. Half-life is the time it takes for one half of the radioactive nuclei in a sample to decay. After half of the radioactive atoms of the material have decayed into another element, half of it still remains, right? Then it takes the same length of time for the next half of the material to decay. Here's an example. Phosphorus 32 is an isotope of phosphorus with a half-life of 14.3 days. Let's say this rectangle is 100 grams of phosphorus 32. In 14.3 days, half of the phosphorus 32 will decay into another element, sulfur 32. You have 50 grams of phosphorus 32 left. In another 14.3 days, half of that, or 25 grams, will decay into sulfur 32. In another 14.3 days, another half decays, and so on. It continues to decay at this exponential rate, but it never really goes away. It gets down to minuscule amounts, but never gets down to zero. How long a half-life is depends on the material. The chart shows you the half-life of different isotopes. Uranium-238, for example, has a really long half-life of about 4.5 billion years. And remember, that's only how long it takes for just half of this isotope to decay. See if you can figure this out. Let's say you have a radioactive material with a half-life of 8 minutes, and let's say you start with 200 grams of the substance. How much of the substance will be left after 32 minutes? The first thing to do is determine the number of half-lives that occur in the total time. You do this by dividing the total time by the half-life. The total time we know is 32 minutes, and the half-life time is 8 minutes. By dividing 32 by 8, we know that 4 half-life periods have occurred. So you divide the initial amount of the sample, which is 200 grams, by 2 4 times. So 12.5 grams of the substance remains after 4 half-life periods. For a more general equation to determine the amount of a substance that remains when the number of half-lives isn't a nice even number, multiply the initial amount times 1/2 raised to the number of half-lives that occur. The equation would look something like this. If we plug in the numbers from our example problem, the remaining mass would be equal to the starting material of 200 grams times 1/2 to the fourth power. And you end up with 12.5 grams of the substance remaining. You can plot it out on a graph. The rate of decay graph for this substance looks like this. Another thing to know is that the half-life of a substance is based on how stable the radioactive isotope is. Half-lives range from less than a millionth of a second up to billions of years. Isotopes that have very short half-lives are very unstable, and those with very long half-lives are much more stable and not as ready to decay. And another valuable thing to know is that the half-life of a radioactive substance is a constant value. It's not affected by external factors, so no matter the temperature, the pressure, or the presence of a magnetic or an electric field, the half-life of a radioactive substance does not change. It's so consistent that scientists use the amount of a substance present in a sample, like a fossil, to determine its age. For example, isotopes with very long half-lives have been used to determine the age of fossils. It's a process called radiometric dating. It was first used at the turn of the 20th century by Ernest Rutherford. He's a key guy since he also discovered the atomic nucleus. To determine the age of a rock, for example, you can see that there is a ratio between an unstable isotope found in the rock, that's called the parent isotope, written NP, and the stable isotope that's created during the parent's radioactive decay. That's the daughter isotope, written in ND. A common parent isotope for determining the age of rocks is uranium-235. It takes roughly 710 million years for it to decay into the lighter, more stable lead-207. That's the daughter isotope. So, the higher the radiometric ratio, the more decay has taken place. The smaller the ratio, the younger the rock. The larger the ratio, the older the rock. Carbon-14 is one of the most commonly used radioactive isotopes in dating artifacts. Carbon-14 is a naturally occurring isotope, and it's extremely rare compared to the more common carbon-12 and carbon-13 isotopes. The half-life of carbon-14 is about 5,700 years, so scientists can use carbon-14 dating to estimate the age of artifacts up to 60,000 years old. Here's how. Organic substances, those that are made of carbon, which all living substances are, ingest carbon-14. And they have the same percentage of carbon-14 in them as is found in the atmosphere. Once that organic substance dies, it no longer takes in carbon-14, and whatever carbon-14 is present in the substance decays. The scientists then use the percentage of carbon-14 that remains in the substance to estimate the age of the artifact. So hopefully now you have a better understanding of radioactive decay, half-lives, and how to use this information to get a better understanding of the world around us. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion, and we'll see you next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.